Well, today we're going to talk about race. Cornel West, the famous black ethnologist at Harvard University, recently published a book called Race Matters. The title is obviously a pun. On the one hand, it's an announcement of the subject of the book, matters having to do with race. On the other hand, it's a claim that West is making, namely that race is something that matters. And I think everybody who's grown up in the United States or practically anywhere else in the world would probably agree with that statement, that at least as a social phenomenon, race matters. There's no question about it. We have race problems that are as sticky and intractable now as they ever were. But, and certainly the Nazis in their campaign to eradicate Europe's Jews believed that race mattered. As a matter of fact, they defined the Jews as a race, and that was that, as far as they were concerned. And they, from the earliest pronouncements that the Nazis were making about Jews, they claimed that one of the main reasons that they opposed Judaism and Jews and Jewry was because the Jewish race was ostensibly inferior, that there were that the Jewish blood was a contaminant and that it was a threat to Aryan Nordic blood and so forth. So obviously the race concept that the Nazis were using had a very strong biological component to it. Well, that's what Paul Benko is going to talk about, is the biological definition of race and history of that concept. I would just ask you, as he's talking and as Michael Thaler is talking, who hasn't got here yet, but he tends to make dramatic late entrances, so I'm not at all upset about that. As they're talking, you might be having in the back of your mind the question that does the question of whether race matters in a biological sense at all. You're going to hear from Paul Benko what race is in a biological sense, and then ask yourself, so were the Nazis right? Was there anything biologically so different about the Jews that they deserved to be exterminated? Well, obviously, the answer that all of us would give to that question is no, but the Nazis succeeded in perpetrating on humanity that they thought that the Jewish race was extremely important. And I think that they contributed significantly to the longevity of the notion that biological race is a really important phenomenon or a really important determinant of people's behavior and people's character and so on. See what you think when you've heard these two lecturers. Paul Benko, Dr. Paul Benko, professor of biology emeritus from Sonoma State University, of the Holocaust, as you have heard, came to the United States after the war and attended Stuyvesant High School in New York City, right? Got his Bachelor of Science at UC Berkeley, then a Master of Science at UC Davis, and a PhD in biochemistry at UC Davis. Worked with the California Department of Health and in private industry, and he has been at Sonoma State since 1970 as a professor of biology. So he will be starting off, and let's see, we'll have to save a seat for Michael up here, and he's bringing a couple of guests, so I hope that we'll have enough free seats for them to sit in. At this point, let me tell you something about him. He also is a survivor. He's Polish. I don't have the precise documentation of, you know, where he got his academic degrees and so forth, but he is a professor of medicine at UC San Francisco at the Med Center there, and has been the president of the Northern California Holocaust Center. Sorry, why am I blanking on that? It's the Holocaust Center in San Francisco. He served in that position for a number of years, and has lectured in this series. Geez, how many times now? Well, this will be the third time since I have been coordinating the series, and he has been here at various times before that as well. I'm sure you'll find him as scintillating as I do. But let us start off with Paul Benko, who's going to talk about the biology of race.
Thank you. I'm the one who has to lower this furthest, as you can see. And continuing in our lecture series, I'd like to remind you briefly that our first lecturer told us about the history of anti-Semitic persecutions. with this on the religious roots. Then Dr. Watrous spoke to us about the history of the era before 1918 and the era between the two Second World Wars and the rise of Hitler. Now, today we're going to look at this from another point of view, namely that of race. And as Dr. Beard pointed out, I'm going to be talking about the biological basis of race and how this came about. Now, the original use of race, according to an anthropologist, was by sailors. And sailors who went to distant lands. And one asks the questions, why not the land explorers? Well, their rationale runs this way. Land explorers never went more than about 25 miles a day. And therefore, they experienced the world in a gradual manner. And they learned the variation of humans as they went along. So, on the other hand, got on their ship, went a long way, and saw drastic differences. Therefore, their dislocation from other humans and their lack of contact with gradations gave them the impression that they were far removed in their observations from that of ordinary person, that there was some kind of a disjuncture in humankind when there was strictly one kind and another kind. Now, you'll see that biologists all contradict this. Biologists of early and recent age know that this does not exist, that there's a great variation between humans. But this was the foundation of the first race concept. And so if you look at the writings of both Marco Polo and an Arab explorer by name of Ibn Battuta in the 14th century, they do not emphasize the difference in the appearance of races of the people that they visited. It's not that they don't mention it at all, but the emphasis is certainly not on that. Whereas if you look at the writings of various naval explorers, you see the sharp differences. And this is what this conclusion is based on. Now, biologically, the use of race came into being with a need to classify the world in an orderly fashion. In classifying the world, biologists like to be organized and neat, and they have to solve two problems. They're universal problems, regardless of whether they were ancient biologists or contemporary biologists, was to organize things so that two biologists would call the same thing the same name. That's a utilitarian concept. But the other one was to establish groupings by which some kind of relationship could be established. Now, notice that by this grouping, I'm not saying anything about descent. All I'm saying is convenient grouping. Now, you could, for example, if you took a library, you could group the books by subject, or you could group the books by size or by color, or any of that be a legitimate grouping. Now, the first biologist problem was simply to group. And some believed in size, and some believed in structure, and some believed in various other things. And no one in a field would like to hide their bushels under some light, so there are many excuses for grouping various things. Now, those people who make little groups and lots of groups are called splitters in biology. We never use this among each other, this term, but believe me, they're either called splitters or lumpers. Now, lumpers are people who like to make big groups, and they don't like to be just about splitting hairs. Then there are other people who just live for the sake of splitting hairs. And the literature of many countries is sprinkled with their efforts to get something named after them, because one of the curses of biology is that if you name something, you get to put your name after it. If we wouldn't practice this, there'd be a lot more sense in a lot of ways, and students wouldn't be tortured learning so many odd names. But this fundamental urge to define things also led to to facing a problem. And the fundamental problem is, when do you have a group that really is a group? And that in biology called a species. And the definition of a species is an interbreeding population. And this is a wonderful term, and all students are supposed to memorize it, and they can spit it back if you wake them up at midnight. The problem is the practical problem of this. Well, you know, these two things are really two species. And the answer is, well, if they interbreed, they are species, or if they're capable of interbreeding. Now, let's take two lions, okay? We're going to take two lions. We're going to take an Indian lion and an African lion. The Indian lions have shorter, darker manes, and the African lions have longer and lighter manes. Now, you say to yourself, is this, how do I know that the Indian will mate with an African lion? Well, nowadays it's easy. You get an egg from a lion and you get the sperm from the other one. Willy-nilly, you know, tranquilized or untranquilized, you can show it in a petri dish. Big deal. Does this happen in nature is the real question. Well, our definition of a species is an interbreeding population, okay? So, theoretically could happen, and there are many examples of overlapping patients where they are close, and we do indeed find this interbreeding. So all this wasn't made up in the mind of a scientist trying to get tenure someplace. But the problem really exists in many other senses, and until very recently it was a very real problem, because without the compliance of the animals, we couldn't decide whether they would ever mate or not. I mean, animals have prejudices too, and they have sex preferences too. And just because, you know, when in a zoo in San Francisco, when they tried mating pandas, it's not always successful. However, we have another way of doing it now, and that is that you extract the DNA, you match the DNA, and if there's a very, very high complementarity between the two, that means the two strands of DNA line up 100%, and we can get pretty close to 100% with a very high level of confidence, as you all learned from the O.J. Simpson trial, then they're the same. So this problem can be solved. So we got the notion now that we have a species which encompasses all, and then we have a subspecies which encompasses some. But it means that all members of the subspecies can integrate. So now then, we will define race for biological purposes as a subspecies. And in this respect, it's true of all things, and nobody has ants about it in biology. And for example, we have races of fungi, to be perfectly neutral. I chose fungi because nobody hates fungi, you know, unless you have your house falling down, right offhand, that is. And some people even like fungi if they like good mushrooms. Well, there are some races of fungi will attack certain plants and not other plants. And that these do mate is without a doubt. There are a lot of Ph.D. theses that have been written and well demonstrated, and we certainly know that exists. There are fungi in California that'll mate with South Africa and produce viable young, and that's the test. You've got to produce viable young, and it certainly works. So now we know what species and subspecies are, and now we'll take up the toucher question. And that the toucher question is when we apply this to humans. When we apply it to humans, then a whole set of things come into being, because the term race is used very freely, frankly, among fungi. It is used freely among other living things. But if you say a race among human beings, you conjure images that we would rather not conjure up on a good day. These images usually bring together those things which we, quote, associate strictly with race, and they're skin color, eye shape, the color of hair, the texture of hair, and nose shape. Those are the ones most widely used. Now, this supposedly establishes the race, and this establishment of the race went unquestioned for a long, long period of time. Now, the ideas associated with this race, however, gradually came out of a history that is tainted by certain attitudes. Now, in looking at modern taxonomy, we have to go back a little bit to understand how we came about some of these concepts. So I'd first like to talk about the contributions of Carolus Linné, who you all heard about one time or another. If you ever went through a biology course, somebody mentioned it. Now, in case you weren't awake when it was mentioned, this is the part of the course that people sleep in a lot. I've taught a lot of biology, so I know where people sleep. Well, Carolus Linné was a Swedish scientist, and he wanted to bring order to madness. Now, while we're bringing order to madness, you have to put yourself in a fine. The Carolus Linné lived between 1707 and 1778. At this time, everybody believes in the special creation of species, everybody. Now, there may be a few quiet ones in the corners who did not, but what they really believe is that every species was created as a single act of God and that there is no relationship between these a priori. So we're not talking about descent. We're talking about an imaginary a box with a lot of pigeonholes in it. And the pigeonholes, in these pigeonholes, we can place every living thing because he did such a good job of organizing it. And it's perfectly clear where things belong. But the fact that two pigeonholes are next to each other doesn't mean that they're cousins or even relatives. It only means that they happen to find themselves there. There's some very broad divisions, animals and plants and this and that. And so you can now split your boxes of pigeonholes and sands of pigeonholes for the purpose of a mental image, but not because they're truly related in a very, very intimate way, and certainly not because they derive from each other or they have a relationship. And he leaves us with this, and so we're now going to ask Carol Linné, what did he do with humans? Well, he divided the humans into four groups. They're called Americanus, Europeus, Asiaticus, and African, and the other terms are obviously evident, and he put them in order, and he made it very clear that he did not distinguish by rank. Okay, it's absolutely clear that that the order that I rank them in is not a superior-inferior order. That comes much later. So he has an equivalent order. Well, Linné had a wonderful student whose name was Friedrich Blumenbach. Now, Friedrich Blumenbach lived from 1752 to 1840. So he was one of the late students of Linné, and he was a truly Renaissance man. Now again, to frame when Johann Friedrich Blumenbach lived, this is the time of the American Revolution, the Declaration of Independence. Political becomes an item, and this permeates the intellectual world. This is the age of Adam Smith, and economic individualism permeates the economic world, and we have the wealth of nations. And here comes Blumenbach, who begins to look at the world in terms of diversity. And Blumenbach looks at the world, and he had enormous respect for his neighbor, but after all, you can't get famous by doing the same thing the old man did. So he added to this observation, and his observation was that he reorganized the arrangement of various people throughout the world, and he started looking at skulls. Some of you who saw the Bernofsky movie on the Ascent of Man may recall that he shows a whole series of skulls, and that was the collection that Blumenbach worked with. Well, he worked on his Ph.D. He did his 1775, and then by 1795 he had changed his mind, and he was beginning to take a look at the skulls, and he looked at the beauty of the skulls, the beauty of the skulls. Okay, this is an era where his eye was so terrific that he could define what beauty is. Now, the Greeks wrote a great deal about beauty, but Blumenbach had his own cap for beauty. And Blumenbach looks at at all these skulls, and he decides that a woman Caucasian skull from the southern slopes, Yes, the southernest slope of Caucasians produces the most beautiful race of men, and he said, I mean Georgia. Now, you know whose name comes to mind in contemporary term? Our chief of staff, the chief of the armed forces, Shugashvili, yeah, he's a Georgian, Stalin was a Georgian, and Shevardnadze were Georgian. So if you can conjure those images out, you're looking at beautiful skulls. So they're all Caucasians, of course. And here starts Blumenbach's hierarchy, and Blumenbach's hierarchy can't leave well enough alone. He categorizes people not simply by their appearance, but also by their color, their humor, their posture, and their behavior. Now, when I say humor, I don't mean ha-ha. I mean the meaning of humor in those days, and those were medieval terms, which were predominantly four different humors. They were cheerful, sluggish, and sluggish, prone to anger, and sad. Those are the four. So I'm now going to read you the classification of Blumenbach, and this will not be on the quiz for those of you who are taking it for credit. Well, the Americans are described as red in color, choleric meaning prone to anger, and upright meaning ruled by, they stand upright and they're ruled by habit. So now come the years, and just if you're betting, you know where to put your money. Europeans are white, they are cheerful, sanguine, cheerful, muscular, and they are ruled by custom. Now you know where tradition comes in with Tevye. Then come the Asians, who are pale yellow, melancholy, sad, that is. They're stiff, and they're ruled by belief. And the Africans are black, and they're sluggish, and they're relaxed, and they're ruled by caprice. Now, reading this, you might conclude that Blumenbach was a racist, and he was not. He was not. He was very anti-slavery. He collected the books of black poets. He had a collection of books of, he praises Phyllis Wheatley, a slave who was a poet and collected her poetry. He was very active in the anti-slavery movement, and we have no reason to believe that he was prejudiced in any sense. But this was his description of the various races. Well, he re-examined this in 1795, and he has a positional hierarchy, and that positional hierarchy is on the handout. But this positional hierarchy, he only published because he believes that nature orders a hierarchy, and it is not a hierarchy of supremacy. Okay, this is not a hierarchy of supremacy. This is a hierarchy of beauty. One derives from the other, but it is not. So in order to make this a symmetrical pyramid, he had to invent a melee, because on one side of your triangle, you see the Caucasian, American, Mongolian, and the other side was the Caucasian, Ethiopian, and so he included the melee. And that was his definition. Now, there is something worthwhile mentioning about Blumenbach besides his knowledge of the world at the time, and that is he begins to champion a single origin of living things. Now, remember, this is an era where everybody believes special creation. Everything is created by itself. So this is the introduction of a unifying theory in biology, which are all much sought after, and which he now brings to the fore. Now, when the moment that one believes in a single origin, in biology, one is faced with the problem of explaining diversity, differentiation. Why is one different from the next, all originated from one? Now, Blumenbach made an effort. So what does he say about skin color? Well, he says if you move from one place to another, your skin color is going to change in a few generations, it's going to get darker. Okay. Now, we know that this isn't true. Yeah, you get sunburn, but that's different. Sunburn's a reversible process. But there is no such evidence, and we know that if you cut off the tails of 1,000 generations of mice, 1,000 of first generation will still going to have tails because you've not changed anything genetically. So in order to change things, we must change the genetic composition. How does he explain something like narrow eye slits? Well, he says the Australians have a lot of gnats gathering there, and that's why they have narrow eye slits. So he at least makes an effort. But he affirms his writing, the moral and intellectual equality of all humans. So in spite of the fact that he chooses Caucasians as beautiful, this does not make him worthier. It just makes him more beautiful. Now, people who study Darwin and subsequent would say, that's a bias because that would improve sexual selection, which is one of the factors in reproduction, certainly. But nevertheless, that was not his intent, and his intent was clear, a variarian view. Now, we move on to our great inspirer, Darwin. If you think of figures in the 1800s, between 1800 and 1900, there are three great historic figures: Marx, Darwin, and Freud. Freud has come under very serious attack. Marx, certainly so. The only one who has thrived in the 20th century, and I suspect will thrive even more in the 21st century, is Darwin. Darwin's ideas, although he was a shy man, a recluse, by no means a self-promoter, he probably today we'd never hear of him because he'd never hire a PR man or work in a place that had one. Darwin, we still know. Darwin introduces the great ideas in biology, and these ideas are more than simple ideas. They're the driving engines that unifies biology in the world today, and that is the force of evolution. But Darwin humbly says two things. One, we're all of common descent. He says it straight outright, not just a little bit, not just slightly, but straight out. We are of common descent. That means we are all related. No more excuses, and there are no more special creations. There are no more races appearing out of nothing in isolated islands in the Pacific and so forth. All those polyphyletic origins are gone. And he says that natural selection is a major force. As you know, Darwin traveled on the HMS Beagle, collected information, fossil and living things, and his study of selective breeding, of course, led to many of his ideas. But his Origin of Species by Natural Selection, his book, galvanized the intellectual world in a very profound way. It is a volcano that started a movement that was so profound that the entire surface near him and around him changed, and had subsequent effects on allied fields. I'll speak about social Darwinism in a minute. And it is so profound that it even dribbles, initiation dribbles into fields today and motivates some fields entirely. I'm not saying that all of what Darwin used in natural selection was always used for good, but I am saying that he gave us a tool by which to measure progress and measure relationships, which is undeniable, and oriented a series of questions for the future. Now, the assumptions of natural selection, there are three fundamental assumptions in natural selection when Darwin pointed this out. And these three fundamental assumptions are that individuals vary in genetic traits. The second one is that some traits lead to greater reproductive success than others. And if these traits lead to greater reproductive success, then they will be widely distributed in the population. So in examining a existing population, we can look at the population and we expect the population A to change with time, because there are new mutations going on at all times, and these mutations are selected through the screen of natural selection. So an example of a natural selection, for example, you would find that people near the North Pole tend to be short and stocky because they're conserving heat loss. People near the equator or in hot climates tend to be tall and thin. Obviously, they have to increase their heat loss, and the surface-to-volume ratio is much better in a tall, thin person over a short, thick one. Now, from his contribution to natural selection, of course, erupted social Darwinism. And I have to mention that here because it overlaps into topics at time. Now, essentially, Darwin also, in his original statement, always said there are more offspring than can survive, and so there is always competition for food and shelter. That's his fundamental premise. So in social Darwinism, states that people in society must compete to survive, and the powerful and wealthy are more fit and therefore deserving of unequal distribution of wealth and power. And this justifies social classes, and poverty proves unfitness. This is Herbert Spencer's version of what Darwin claimed. The problem with the argument is fundamentally that, and that's very much of an abbreviation, that in the 19th century, the argument was by the way, promoted with, quote, good intentions, unquote. And there was an immobility in terms of classes. There was a stratification of classes in England where you couldn't go from one place to another because it depended upon your rank relative relationship. And so, the Spencer and the others said the reason you found brilliance, intelligence in all classes was because you couldn't move from one class to another. In other words, there was no sorting going on in nature. But if you equalize opportunity, then there would be a sorting, and you know, all the big rocks would be at the bottom, and all the little ones are, I should say, all the big capacities would be on the bottom, the small capacities on the top, and supposedly everything would work out. The ultimate outcome of this, of course, the question is there equal opportunity, and is there, can people rise to the top equally regardless of where they start? And I suspect that you know the answer to that. Now, in explaining these problems, we return now to the source of biological variations, because we're stuck with the problem that there are indeed different people throughout the world, and what is the source of this variation. So we're going to take a look at the three recognized forces here. And one is natural selection, and I gave you an example of the short stature and the tall, thin person and so on. Now, another one, a very important, particularly for humans, it's called sexual selections. Not other animals don't do this also. But in we know that in sexual selection occurs, and in some societies, for example, large bottoms are preferred in females, and in some small bottoms. In some societies, the color of nipples of females are found more attractive if they're deeper colored than if they're lighter colored. in the hairiness of males, for example, in European males, is recognized as attractive in places, whereas the lack of hairiness of Asian males is recognized in others. So we have sexual selection as a major factor. And we have, of course, the stature of musculature. Now, in addition to natural selection and sexual selection, we have a third aspect of variation, and that's called random variation. I mean, a variation which has no sexual advantage, which has no survival advantage, but it still occurs. And the example I could think of are fingerprints. Now, imagine that we're going to redivide the world in a race of fingerprints. Do you know who you would be related to? Some people in Southeast Asia. If you're from Western Europe, you would be. If you're from Eastern Europe, you might be related to a group of Aborigines in Australia. It's a very strange way to make a subspecies who's separated by 6,000 to 8,000 miles. So our species, our subspecies, which were labeled by, quote, color, nose appearance, hair, and so forth, don't hold in these. And this is an example of non-concordance, of what essentially geneticists call non-concordance. If you had these subspecies, or these, quote, races that were strictly races that were separated for so long, then you would not expect them to have many identities or overlapping characteristics. You would expect to get a lot of different characteristics. Now, we have two lines of evidence to tell you why it is that this isn't so. First line of evidence was before the Human Genome Project. In 1972, a geneticist at Harvard by name of Richard Lewontin did an interesting study where he examined something like 168 groups, 16 different, quote, races. So these were genetic races, so he didn't take the major, quote, recognized races, subdivided them, so he had better definitions of groups. And he asked the following questions. A, in what are they different, and in what percentage does this difference amount to? Well, it turns out that the, quote, classic difference amounts to 6.3%. What does this mean practically? It means that there is somebody of a different color than you sitting next to you. They may be more closely related to you than the person of the same color sitting next to you. Because if you're looking at 93%, 93.7% versus 6.3% difference. This has practical consequences. You need a heart transplant. Don't look for somebody in your own race. Look at everybody, because you have no way of knowing who's going to have the best match. And it has a very, very great application today, especially in when we're concerning donors of organs. Now, if you look at variations that are not superficial, such as eye color or hair or nose or color or skin color, and you look at the differences in hemoglobin of blood, you would classify the following groups as a single race. The Greeks and Italians are one groups, would be one group, and Swedes and the Hossas. The Hossas are the tribe in South Africa to which Nelson Mandela belongs to. The Swedes and Hossas are now related if you look at sickle cell anemia and other ways of relating to resistance to malaria. Now, I'm sure have heard of epicanthic fold. These are the folds that the Japanese are so busy removing right now with in Japan because they want to look, quote, Western. Well, if you look at epicanthic fold, then the Kong, actually I should say Kong, of Africa, the Japanese and Chinese would be one race. If you looked at at the shovel-shaped teeth, which is supposed to be the mark of everybody among Asians, they're related to the Swedes. Now we look at something that's more familiar to this population, lactase-positive people. In other words, these people are not milk intolerant. Those who are lactose intolerant come next. But first, those who are not lactose intolerant, the Norwegians and the Arabs are now related, their North Indians are related, and the Fulani of northern Nigeria are related. Now, that gives you something to really think about of a group that is supposedly related. Obviously not. If you go to look at the ABO blood type group, the Germans and New Guineans have exact same percentage distribution of ABO blood type group. There is a tennis star from South Africa who is classified as a European in Africa and as an African in Europe. His name was Yannick Noah, by the way. Now look at the anthropologist's view of this. The anthropologists have virtually abandoned race as a useful designation in recent years. I looked at the review of 1970 anthropology textbooks, and in the 1970-1975 anthropology textbooks review indicates that most of them are more than half of them dropped race as an item of discussion. And the physical anthropologists, only half of them believed that race was useful for them. Now, I'm not saying the race does not exist. That's not the point of this. But if you're looking at race as a congruence of characteristics, that's very questionable. Now, in contemporary studies, we use classical anatomic studies, population genetics, the biochemical criteria, which I mentioned to you, and the molecular criteria. You've probably all heard about the Human Genome Project. The Human Genome Project intends to decode the sequence of bases which make up a, quote, human being, and know the entire sequence. This would theoretically tell us what the sequence is. It does not tell us what an adult is, okay? Please, that's not the conclusion. It only tells us what human average can send. Now, there is another project besides the Human Genome Project about which you've probably heard a lot less, and that's called the Human Variability Project that examines all the variable groups in throughout the world in order to discover the basis of these variations and to conserve these variations. There have been a lot of political and social conflict about this. Some minority groups felt that they would not be recognized in the genetic banks, and that would be true unless their genomes would be saved. But the principal advantage of this is that we have an unbiased way of determining who came from where, what is an identity, and what is a difference without historic opinion, social discourse, political pressure, or primal prejudice taking its role. Now, in this sense, we will have an entirely independent basis. But I will make a prediction. My prediction is that we're going to discover that with the rare exceptions of a few really, really isolated islands throughout the world, we are all mutts. We are great mixtures of many, many successful genes that have been sorted throughout centuries of trial. And these will point to the vast adapt that humans have made in every mode of their being. And I emphasize in every mode of their being. I will come in a moment to a singular mode that is presently the Bible of racism in the United States, and possibly will have future uses in this. And you'll understand that we're talking about the total mode of survival, not just one. But let me turn now to the Bible of racism, which is called The Bell Curve by Mr. Herrnstein and Murray. Ernstein and Murray have a lot of publications, and they're known as academically respectable, and they're not trash, and so they will you will get a hearing, and they will be properly examined, and they have been in a number of cases. Now, the publication's book is, in a way, a welcome event. It is a welcome event because what used to be pushed under the table and what was the agenda of the most horrible racist is now stated in plain language, so we can examine it for its full content. What the bell curve says is that race and differences are due to genetic factors which are immutable, and therefore intelligence is an inherited and immutable characteristic, has nothing to do with environment, and that's it. Now, there's no point in running better schools or worse schools. You're just wasting your money. It's inherent that how people are, and this is biologic determinism now becomes the basis of a social philosophy. The problem about this biologic determinism is that its fundamental statement is flawed. What it says is that genetics is destiny. Okay. That whatever is genetic, you're destined to have or to be. That's not what genetics is. And no geneticist on either side of the Iron Curtain ever claimed that. There are a few cases of diseases. If you have it, there's a 100% chance that you will suffer the consequences. But even if you take something as highly dispersed as breast cancer, the breast cancer gene, and that was recently isolated at BRCA1 and 2 and whatever, none of them are 100%. They're not 100%. Look at the literature. They're 81%. They might even go to 90%. Now, for scientists, they say, oh, that's good enough, fine. You know, I made my money. I'm going to get another grant. We can go on, and you know, getting 90% cure would be anything, it would be wonderful. But you have to remember the other 10% if we look at the entire population. It means that genetics is not destiny, it is not certainty. It certainly means a high probability, but high probability is different from certainty. Now, Huntington's disease, for example, is literally a sentence, and there is not much we can do about it now. But we are approaching the era where the sickle cell anemias will be much more manageable, considering what you read about just this week and about the cloning of sheep. It raises enormous problems, but it also raises enormous possibilities that those genetic diseases that we could even hope to deal with could be dealt with. But the important point I'm making here is not the treatment of the disease. The important point I want to make is that genetics is not destiny. And the implication by anyone in the 20th century that genetics is inevitable destiny is as misleading as any of the preachings of Nazism that's ever made, and just as insidious. It is just as insidious as people who preach against vaccination. Because no, we know they're wrong. We don't have to try it again. Any more waste of effort in that time is just simply waste of effort. Now, for example, to show you about this immutable differences that Herrnstein and Murray talked about. In their tables, they never discuss black children adopted by affluent or intellectual homes whose IQ shows no difference with those of others of their co-age group. The standard argument, their standard argument is that black children be test that on the average 15 points below white children on the IQ scale. And that, and they argue that this is inevitable and unchangeable and so forever and ever. Well, here is one example. The other are points to the increases in IQ of nations since World War II. Now, if a national IQ increases, it's hard to imagine such mass migration that would raise the level of children's IQ. So what we think is better living conditions. And if you compare out-of-wedlock-born children in Germany, for example, born and raised in Germany, having white or black fathers, there is no significant difference in their IQ when tested, regardless of bias of test. There are other more technical aspects to the arguments against Hearn and Murray, including their equivalence of a so-called G value to a so-called IQ value, which is the only one of three possible modalities that can be measured, and these don't work out. Well, okay, thank you. I'd like to leave you with three conclusions, and then I would like to add a closing word. My three conclusions are, one, human variability is greater within the group between the racial groups. The second one is that the description of race are not reliable indicators of linkage of characteristics with respect to human potential or any measurable biologic characteristic. And the third is that genetics configuration of all living things, including man, are not predetermined, and therefore determinism is not justifiable as social policy. Now, in closing, I'd like to read something that relates more closely to what I said. By the way, I meant to mention that if you think that the bell curve is not used, those of you who read the Anderson Valley Advertiser, it's a very interesting newspaper. Its motto is, "A newspaper should have no friends." They quote Joseph Pulitzer. But this is north of us in Mendocino County. The prosecuting attorney involved in a case the trial of Bear Lincoln in the presence of Judge Golden, and it turns out that something like 1,650 or 60% of the eligible Native Americans are not on the jury rolls in Mendocino County. Now, if I told you this about the South in 1950, nobody would bat an eyelash, but this is 1997 and it's California. And this is what Williams said. It was his belief that when white and black races mix, the offspring was black because black genes are dominant. He confused discussion of phenotype with genotype, appeared to be drawn directly from the Bible of racist apology, the bell curve. When he was asked about his objection about what is your objection to putting everyone who's eligible in Mendocino County on the jury master list, he replied, "I think we shouldn't go off the race neutral list." This is a county attorney. Now, I'm indebted to my colleague Phil Beard for this extract, which I translated, so the translation errors are mine, the original is Phil's. This is an item that was dictated by Bormann, a very big wig in the Nazi hierarchy, as something that Hitler told him personally. This is between February and April of 1945, so this is the end of the Third Reich. "The Nordic racial awareness is only aggressive against the Jewish race. In this connection, we speak only about the Jewish race for linguistic convenience, because in the strict sense of the word, from a genetic point of view, there is no Jewish race." Does this surprise you? An entire mass murder scheme was based on precisely that. Conditions force us to designate nation because the reality is the existence of a racially and spiritually, although someone may think intellectually, common group to which all Jews of the world recognize their belonging completely independently of the national affiliation of their passports. In other words, there is an international conspiracy that naturally recognizes itself through the ether, and without affiliation. It is this human group that we designate as the Jewish race. In spite of the fact that the Hebrew religion serves them as a, quote, shingle, in the sense like the shingle of a doctor outside, in no way is there a question of a religious community based on common profession of faith. The Jewish faith is above all the spiritual, in some opinion of some intellectual community. Anthropologically, the Jews do not exhibit in any case those common characteristics by which they would be considered a homogeneous race. In spite of this, each Jew, without a doubt, hides in his arteries a few drops of what we call Jewish blood. A spiritual race is harder and more enduring than a natural race. That's it.
Stunning quote. Get in touch with me. I can get it for you. Without further ado, let's go straight to Michael Thaler. Let's see. Jerry, can you help get the screen down and set up the overhead projector? The rest about himself. The only other thing that I would add is that he, this summer, spent a good...
Point me at the audience and I'll do the rest. Okay, well, I'm not supposed to talk about myself here, so I won't. Phil, well, you've just heard Paul Benko talk about what you might call the science part of this talk, because my job it is to, as I see it at least, to talk about the non-science part or the pseudoscience part, the part where you take the science and you turn it into ideology. And in fact, I'm just trying to shuffle these projection slides or sheets because I'm teaching a course at San Francisco State University this semester with a title that keeps changing depending on which catalog and which list you look at. But it's something like the history of racist genetics or race, genes, and society. That's the topic, and it's 15 lectures long, and I'm going to try to condense it into the next, 30 minutes? How much time do I have? 30 minutes. Okay. Well, I'll try. So I heard about the origins of genetics as we understand it, that is clinical genetics, and now, of course, we're entering what I call the Dolly era, which is, you know, the sheep that was just cloned, and I just had a long, heated discussion with my son, who's an MD PhD down, or at least a student, an MD PhD graduate student down in San Diego, UCSD, and he said, Dad, don't get excited. There's nothing new about this. We could have done that a year, 10 years ago. I said, of course there's something new about this. You may achieve two of your major goals. One is you never have to get married, and the other is you don't have to have parents. And you've been working on this all your life. So someday, perhaps, this will be known as the beginning of the Dolly era, because essentially all these discussions about the other and the yourself and the extensions of yourself and your community and your society and your country, which this is all about, may become all moot because you simply clone yourself. Ad infinitum, and you can. There's no limit. I mean, you can have 20, so you can have 200, if it's not regulated, and I doubt it can be. Actually, you know, this is really going to become an entirely different society. And you know, even while you can talk about how we're going to be solving all those diseases and all these wonderful new ways of treating. In fact, the reason they did that experiment is because they were trying to genetically engineer a sheep that will be able to secrete new kinds of proteins and other kinds of goodies in the milk, so that that sheep would essentially become a little factory for nice drugs and compounds that we can't manufacture at the moment very easily. And so, you know, that's the rationale. And I noticed with some amusement that the stock on the company that was paying for this research went up some like 60% in a half hour after the news release came out. So, but that's just the tip of the iceberg. I believe that that kind of experiment, which was done very simply, and it's really primitive, quote my son, primitive, It is simple, and it wasn't done, I believe, because nobody wanted to do it. And now it is done, and the cat's out of the bag, and I think we're facing a whole new era. And I guess if you don't want to call it the Dolly era, you can call it the new eugenics era, because that's really what this is about. We now have the tools to do precisely what Nazis and many other races before them wanted to do, and that is to generate what you might call, if not the super race, certainly the superior race, because if you can engineer a sheep to, let's say, manufacture human interferon, you can certainly engineer a human being to grow better or to have characteristics that they're deemed desirable by the particular society. So while it is powerful science, it is still driven very much by social and humanistic values. And it really boils down, this whole thing boils down to values, and where do they come from? And Phil Beard, whom I thank for this invitation, has written in his little letter that I should really try to focus more on how to combat evil, I believe is how you put it, quote unquote. And of course, that is, of course, the real question. Where do we get our marching orders? Where do we find out what's good and what's bad? You know, who are the guys in the good in the white hats and who are the guys in the black hats? And up to about 150 years, I probably will not use the overheads. As I get into this, I'll probably not have time for the overheads. But as we get into this 150-year period of this scientific era, you find an obvious shift, among other things, an obvious shift in what I call the explanatory system. You know, human beings, I guess, are distinguished by the fact that when they're born and very soon after they're born, they're very, very vulnerable to the elements, as you well know. A newborn naked baby couldn't last more than a day out there in the elements without protection from mother and everybody else. And so the human species is born with a knowledge that it is distinct from the rest of the universe, that the body, the human body, your own body, is a self that is really distinctly separate from the world around you. And that means that from the very beginning, every child has a sense of not really being at home in the world. That's why it needs parents and grandparents and all of this paraphernalia around it, whereas any puppy just takes off because the puppy doesn't have a consciousness of the connection between its own self, its own dimensions, its limits, and the world around it. So the tiger in the jungle is part of the jungle. It doesn't understand that it is not part of the jungle. It's just part of itself and the whole world around it. So we have this consciousness of being very different. And basically that requires an explanatory system, a way of explaining the world around us so we can exist in it. Everything we do and say boils down to, what does it mean? What does it mean? Explain it to us, you know? What doesn't make sense, right? All of this kind of approach to the world creates a construct of the human mind that explains that hostile universe to us, ourselves. Well, of course, at a point which is reached sooner or later, there are phenomena in our world which we cannot explain, you know? Lightning, eclipses, tidal waves, earthquakes, whatever. Very dangerous phenomena, and we cannot explain them to ourselves. And so we invent a superpower, a power that is a projection of ourselves, which we can call God or nature or whatever. But again, it provides an explanation. So we don't know how this works, but someone out there does, someone more powerful, more wise, more omnipotent than we are, and therefore we are protected. Okay, that was the explanatory system from ancient times on to about 150 years ago. When explanation started to, actually you might say 400 years ago if you want to date it from a point like Galileo. Okay, Galileo was a very, very devout Catholic, and he didn't know what the hell to make of this data that was coming in from Copernicus and Kepler that kept insisting, the data kept insisting, despite everything he could try, that the Earth is not the center of the universe, that the Earth is rotating around the sun, and out the window went the entire explanatory system if one pursued those conclusions. So that's why, in fact, the Church, which was very well aware that this was a real fundamental challenge to its authority and the whole concept of meaning in the world, actually dragged him through the coals, as you well know, and he finally signed a statement that he takes it all back. But there was no stopping the genie out of the bottle, just like there was no stopping Dolly. You know, once it's out of the bottle, it's out there, and it's for everybody to use, and it all depends on your system of meaning, on your explanatory system, and derives a series of value judgments that operate to explain the world. And so science became more and more the predominant explanatory system, as manifested by, in fact, the last sort of nail in the old coffin, which was the Darwinian theory, that Darwin's Origin of the Species, of course, said, no, we're not descended from Adam and Eve, we're descended from monkeys, and, you know, that whole scientific argument, creationism versus evolutionary theory. Well, it's very clear, if one uses just those two as metaphors, tension between these two explanatory systems, one can see that creationism is pretty well gone, more or less, though it keeps raising its head here and there in various places because of this need that we have to explain things on a basis that makes us safe in this world, versus evolutionary theory, which is no longer considered theory any more than Einstein's theory of relativity is actually considered a theory. It has been as proven as anything else can possibly be established using scientific data. But you know, you have to keep in mind that science, of course, is based on the physicality of the world. Things work inherently have no meaning. The meaning in the sense that we have. And what is that need that we have for additional extraneous meaning, extra scientific meaning? Well, I see that in clinic every day. Every day as a physician, I hear over and over again that the modern doctors have forgotten how to deal with human beings, with patients, that the whole patient is what we really have to deal with and not the organ and not the disease. You know, I hear this ad infinitum. What this boils down to is the need of the human being, because of its consciousness, its sense of itself in the world, to think of itself as more than just the sum of the parts. We used to have a game in medical school. We used to add up all the iron and all the copper and all the calcium and all the materials that a human being, our body, is made up of, and we added up. And when I was in medical school 150 years ago, it came. The price was $23.56, I believe, when I was graduating. That was the value of the human being to each other, you know. Well, now inflation and all that's probably around $93.40 or something like that. $93.40. That's the cost or the value of the human being if one looks at it purely scientifically. Well, we laugh because it's nonsense to us, because we know we have a sense of ourselves as worth far more, way beyond the physical composition of our bodies. And this is what this is all about. On the one hand, we accept science as the explanation for the world. We go to the priest to find out when the next eclipse is going to be. We go to the astronomer. So we accept the authority of the physical world out there, and yet we refuse to accept the idea that that's all there is to it, and that we have no quote-unquote soul or spirit. And in fact, on the talk show yesterday morning about this cloning, somebody called up and said, so if you clone 10 versions of yourself, are they all going to have a soul? And which soul are they going to have? You know, are they going to have a separate soul from or what? You know, because genetically these are identical copies of whoever gets cloned. So are you cloning the soul as well? It hits at the bottom of this argument, and so my introduction is also in a sense my conclusion, that what this struggle is all about is to discover an explanatory system that goes beyond the physical, that has replaced the old. Well, transcendental, I guess, system of God and powers beyond us. This is, as we turn into this next millennium, I believe the major challenge to our own survival. Because while we'll now have complete control of our own evolution is out the window, in fact. We can do what we want. We can make ourselves tall or short or copy ourselves or mix. Paul mentioned about the Human Diversity Project, actually. That's the one at Stanford. Well, the Human Diversity Project says that if you do a complete genome sequencing like they're doing now, you end up with a particular genome, a somebody's specific genome. So who should that be? Who should be the ideal gold standard that we're going to be comparing everything else to? Well, you know, I suggested to them some very odd possibilities. But the bottom line is, as Paul suggested, the molecular, the reflection of what you said about the intra-racial differences are greater than the extra or inter-racial differences, the reflection of that in the code is, in fact, that 99.3% of the human genome is identical. everybody shares 99.3%. So we're talking about 0.7% that is really diverse. And now, of course, the Diversity Project is trying to look at tribal differences, communal differences. You know, there was an article in the paper just about, 3 weeks ago, somebody decided to look at everybody named Cohen, and they found, in fact, certain sequences that were shared by people who are named Cohen, you know. So now we have a priest gene, I guess, in that sequence. So what I'm saying is clearly we're all human beings. Not only that, but the confirmations of Darwin's theory that are now coming in at that level are just mind-boggling. Because now it isn't just simply a matter of comparing, let's say, the Australian Aborigine with the Lap in Finland, but in fact, one can take any protein like an enzyme or something, cytochrome C reductase. I just pulled that off of the air. And it has been shown that cytochrome C reductase in a horse versus a mouse versus a lizard versus a fish clearly shows great homology, that's the word, homology, it's identical sequences in all of those. And so that if one looks at the human cytochrome C reductase molecule versus, let's say, the snake one, then there are maybe 5 or 10 residues pieces that are different out of maybe thousands. Okay, so even in that sense, we're closely related to everything else in the world that's alive. Okay, so what these distinctions are really beginning to break down, because now we can take the snake cytochrome C reductase gene and stick it into the human embryo, and now if that gives us an advantage, let's say, to fight off snake toxin or something, then of course in future that's going to be gene therapy, obviously, because that way it makes us completely safe and resistant to all kinds of problems. That's of course the future, the positive, the upside of that, okay? So now, to get back to this period, let's see if this works. I will try to project at least one slide, so I didn't drag it all the way here for nothing. Yeah, there is a switch. I know. There we go. Okay, this was the slide that I showed last time, and now we can control it. Yeah, perfect. You see, science really works. It's predictable. That's one of the scariest things about it. Okay, so now we have this period when all of this knowledge was really starting to come out. For the first time ever, medicine and biology and most of the other sciences were placed on a rational cause and effect related basis. So now we didn't talk anymore about humors and elements, and though it's coming back, you know, how many of you are getting acupuncture and qi and all this kind of Chinese stuff that says it has to work because it's been around for 200 years, right? Well, I'm not so sure that I would advertise it that way, since it hasn't changed in 2,500 years. And the point is that now this old medicine has been replaced by very, very focused, specific cause and effect relationships. And this was done largely by German doctors around the middle 50s, somewhere around there, Virchow and Koch and all those people who looked down a microscope and said, that's a cell, let's look at what happens to it when it's sick and when it's well, and then focus on disease, and this whole thing about don't focus on the patient, focus on the disease, started at that time, because I can't do anything about the patient. I can certainly do something about the disease, and that's why there's this distinction, because that's science. Science is reductionist. Again, it's the sum of its parts, period. Okay, nothing greater than that, and that medicine has always been uncomfortable in accommodating that loss, because in fact, with the science came that loss of that extra dimension. So what happened was the idea that we're to an era, that's 150 years ago, where slowly but surely we're going to learn all there is about the body and how it works and the diseases and all the mechanisms. And in fact, they were right, because we are at this time moving into a fast forward mode, if you will, of precisely that process that was begun 150 years ago. So having a control of the environment in terms of hygiene, in terms of bacterial control, in terms of new drugs, meant that they also wanted to do internal control. What's internal? Genetics. That's what we bring to the table from our ancestors. And so they began to look at those elements, especially after Darwin showed that there was adaptability and survival of the fittest and all these selection, natural selection. So it became very clear that the science for the next millennium or the next century would be something that they called eugenics, which we probably rename some other, well, we're renaming it now. We're calling it gene therapy, in fact. That's what eugenics is. Eugenics has acquired a bad name for good reasons, because it was used for bad purposes, as I said. The explanatory system was the wrong system to be used. In any case, what they're saying here very clearly is that, I don't think I need that. Okay, here, notice the symbolism, the palpable borrowing of the old symbolism. This is a tree of life. This is from the old Bible. And yet it's preempted for the new system. And notice the date, New Jersey in the place, Third International Eugenics Congress, New York City, August 21st, 1902. Fateful year, just a year before Hitler came to power. But notice that what is eugenics? It's the sum total of the rest of human knowledge. You see, it's got genetics, it's got, anthropology, environment, developmental studies, everything that goes into a knowledge of this body of ours and how it works gets translated into the new scientifically justified, validated tree of life. And so to understand, which was just as triumphalist as we are about, you know, the future, about what we can do with our science, here's an example. Here is the proceedings of the first national conference on race betterment. Now, race betterment, notice, is not racial betterment, but race betterment. So you have to understand the terminology. That also changes with time. And race, at that context, was the human race. We still have that idea, the entire human race. So it isn't a bunch of races. It's, in a Darwinian sense, as a species separate from other species. So how do we better race? That is us. That is the ultimate goal of any medical system. That is to improve health, to eliminate diseases, to make a more productive, a healthier country, a healthier people. And so, Battle Creek, Michigan, interesting place. Who can guess why it was in Battle Creek? Oh, there's an old man laughing. Okay, tell me, why? Crispy, well, it's not Crispies, it's the other thing. Cornflakes, yes. You see, sometimes my origins show. If I were really a native of this country, I would know immediately the difference between Rice Krispies and cornflakes. In any case, yes, he was a great philanthropist, and he pulled together all these famous people in his factory place and started to talk about race betterment. And in that catalog, in that program, which I have, everything was discussed about the future, including such things as how immigration law should be structured to take cognizance of the new understanding of inherited diseases, and how we don't want to bring foreigners in carrying those diseases, for example, and also where the populations are that are most likely to introduce these kinds of bad genes, if you will. And here is an American professor, Davenport, talking about poorhouse type source of defect, and you can see that there is one woman who is feeble-minded, subject to epileptic fits, and she gives forth to, she is descended from a feeble-minded mother and a shiftless, worthless father, like, nice terminology, scientific. And she has spent most of her life in the almshouse, which is on welfare, of course, and all of her children have been inmates. One is by a Negro, whom she met in the almshouse. You see all these incidental things. And two of the children died in infancy, one of whom little is known, died at the age of 18, and the remainder two are feeble-minded, and one, from a sire of criminal tendencies, is an epileptic imbecile. Now, you know, that is a fantastic paragraph. It covers the waterfront. It actually covers all problems that we face today, and we're trying desperately to do similar things with these ideas. Poor house is like the homeless, you know, basically. And you've got all these ideas that, you have mental retardation among that population, you have criminal behavior as an inherited problem, all of these kinds of things. And of course, in that time, interracial mixing was another problem. So all of these things basically were part of the culture at the time, and the culture was driven by the new science. And finally, probably the only last thing I'll show here is, just so before we become too superior about it, here is 1927, a very famous case, Buck versus Bell, in which the sterilization laws that almost every state had passed in the meantime in order to prevent the propagation of these bad diseases. This came to the Supreme Court in this particular family who refused to be sterilized before they got married because they had a long history of mental retardation. And the Supreme Court of the United States on the side of protecting society against this kind of propagation, this sort of breeding of undesirable traits. And you notice the most famous sentence of this is here. It's often quoted. Three generations of imbeciles, the same terminology. This is 1927 now. Imbeciles are quite enough, and I don't have to show you the name underneath that. And so just to show you that there were, this was spread throughout the sectors of society. It wasn't just simply, you know, the right wing, just, you know, the left wing. Again, this was a new explanatory system. This was going to give us a chance to develop this great new society. Okay. And you notice also the very glib, interesting, Paul mentioned that we now know that vaccination is acceptable and we shouldn't fight against it because it's a waste of time. With science has proven that it's very effective. He thought so too. And in fact, what he did is, notice what he did. He said, the principle that sustains compulsory vaccination is broad enough to cover cutting the fallopian tubes. Okay? Value system. To him, this was a matter of public health measures, quarantine, control. It was in the service of race betterment, in the service of improving the world. Okay, and the Americans were actually quite jealous eventually in the 30s of the Germans, who suddenly had a government which said, go to it. I mean, right now we are going to build this great new nation using the advanced scientific principles, many of which, most of which come from our own German doctors. And you had these triumphal addresses to the faculties of medicine and biology at the takeover, Macht ergreifung, you know, takeover, the power takeover in Germany, and then Anschluss in Austria. I can quote you one from the rector of the medical school in Vienna right off the top of my head, where he said, we live in great times, we doctors, because the first time ever we are in a position to imp ancient Greek injunctions. That means Hippocratic injunctions. Because now, for the first time, the greatest duty and the greatest glory of medicine is the health of the nation. The society around us is waiting for us to keep it healthy and to make it prosper. And so the focus shifts from the individual patient as patient to Volkskörper, the body of the nation, which is mentioned in that quotation, as the new patient, okay? It's a shift which then justified him in saying next to this that we have the tools and the state will give us the rights and the control, and we will now proceed to have in our hands control over marriage, over jobs, over mobility, over studies, you know, where you go and all that. Everything you could do in this new world was dependent on a shine, on a piece of paper from a doctor. And also, if you were found inadequate, not to be superior, then you could marry, perhaps, but you would have to be sterilized. And of course, the doctors then did the sterilization as well. So the doctors had a tremendous amount of power. And often, I lecture on this, I introduce it by saying the Nazi regime, the Third Reich, was in a sense a public health program, a general public health program, where they were going to use all of these techniques to develop what they wanted to develop. And of course, they did that with their ideology, which again was this pseudoscientific mixture where they said that, but there are obviously some genes we don't want. Well, the simple ones are the retarded people, the ones with inherited diseases, the ones who are epileptic, paraplegic, and so on. But the next group is the Jews and the Gypsies and other elements, quote unquote, that have been burdening our society. And now that we are proceeding with these new tools, we might as well get the job done right. And you can eliminate, let's say, a genetic strain from your population is to literally eliminate it the way you do a disease or a bacterial infection or something like that. So you can see how this science was then preempted and used in ways which fostered certain or promoted certain ideologies. So basically, if I want to say how do we fight evil, I have to say that we have to constantly doubt, Okay? Now, that's very simple, because remember Aristotle said, cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. I think it was Aristotle. Descartes said, dubito ergo sum. That's the point. Cartesian doubt, okay? And basically, that evolution from cogito ergo sum, whoever said it, and to dubito ergo sum, which is I doubt, therefore I am, is very interesting, because Descartes was this sort of great, you know, scientific genius of his era, and he understood that both in terms of scientific knowledge and in terms of wisdom, general human knowledge, one has to constantly challenge assumptions and so-called known facts. And if one had challenged this sort of tremendous, powerful ideologies and drives that swept entire societies before them, like the Nazi ideology, or like communism, if you will, which was the other major powerful ideology, then, of course, you would always be standing up against the current, which is always difficult, and everybody is rushing around you because the line of least resistance and also the advantage is with the crowd, with the movement, with the river moving you down. But if you want to know a formula, at least as far as I can tell you, which is limited to my own experience, it is always question what seems the most obvious to you. Always question, always data, always examine the alternate possibility. If you do that, at least you will see that there are generally many, many answers to any question, and you will also see something else. That what determines this river, this trend, and where it's going, is not the answers, the explanations, but it's the questions that you ask. That's where humanism and science meet, because the scientist is a human being, and it is out of the depths of his or her own personal experience that he decides or she decides what to study, what questions to ask. And it is those questions that determine the nature of the answers. And so if one studies that period, one finds obvious evidence of this, for instance, in something like a graph that I'm trying desperately to find here. Yes, okay, here is a graph that shows graphically, if you'll pardon the pun. For instance, what happened in German schools, up there above, genetics, anthropology, and racial hygiene and eugenics taught in German universities since 1900. Well, you can see that at the time of the Nazi takeover and prior to that, there is 33 right there, but you can see a definite trend up in all of those for at least 10, 15 years before the Nazi takeover, which means it was already beginning to be part of the culture. It was becoming an explanatory system. I mean, what is I just showed you the American version. What is anthropology? What is genetics? All of this is mixed together in a concept called racial hygiene, cleaning up the genes, if you will, borrowed from the infectious disease world, hygiene for, you know, the spread of tuberculosis and so on. And so all of these are really general public health kind of concepts used in the service of a new ideology, which was very triumphal, solidly self-explanatory, because all it said was, we're going to get rid of the bad internal factors, the bad genes in us, and we're going to get rid and control the external environment. Who could argue with that? I mean, it's a fantastic story. Well, it may be fantastic because it's self-evident, it's obvious, precisely why you should start asking questions. What if? Just let's see what this statement is based on. It reminds me when I was, as a medical student, I worked in a mental hospital in New York, because in those days I was toying with the crazy idea of becoming a psychiatrist, which cured me, my experience. But I remember taking my first trip downtown New York, and the Salvation Army was running a campaign to salvage, in fact, this other thing, this religious concept of the world, and it had these little signs all over the subway cars, which said, Christ is the answer. Christ is the answer. And some guy had snuck into the warehouses next day, and the next morning, all these thousands of cars all over New York had a little subscript that said, what was the question? Okay. Well, I tell you this little story off the top of my head because it really is the question that matters. Once you ask the right question, you're going to be led to this answer. So I'm going to stop right here since my time is probably off. And maybe if you have any questions for Paul and me, I'd be very happy to answer. But that's the best I can do about, you know, preventing evil from rearing its ugly head and from using science in ways which are entirely counterproductive and inappropriate. Thank you very much.
Bravo, Michael Thaler. I don't know anybody who can get more into a half hour than you. It tends not to work too well when we try to do what I'm going to try to do now, but let's see if we can make it work well. Since we did try to have to pack so much into today's joint lecture, and we are out of time, obviously those of you who need to leave, feel free. But I would like to ask that we stay for another 5 or 10 minutes and take questions. So if you have to leave, go ahead. But perhaps you could do it as inobtrusively as possible so that people that do have questions can ask them. Oh, yeah. Obviously, the students who have to leave, you have to sign up on your sign-up sheet here, too, and we'll understand that that's necessary. But are there questions of either Dr. Benko or Dr. Thaler? Yeah.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay, what was the question? You want to repeat?
The question is, wasn't sterilization of undesirables used in the United States as well during the 30s?
Yes. Yes, I sort of suggested, implied it, but I didn't specify it. Yes, those laws, in fact, I did say that there were laws on the most of states, on the books of most states, which mandated sterilization for certain groups, of, such as epileptics, people with obvious inherited diseases, other things like blindness, deafness, and mental retardation. These caused about 40,000 people in the United States to be sterilized against their will. And the more interesting fact is that half of them were sterilized in California. And about 20,000 were sterilized in California. And this case that I showed, the Supreme Court case, was a challenge to one of these laws. I think it was in West Virginia or someplace like that. And it went all the way to the Supreme Court and decision of the Supreme Court. It was for forced sterilization because they equated cutting off the fallopian tubes with forced enforced vaccination.
Yeah, Jerry? The question was, who engineered the ideology of eugenics?
Oh, you want to pick that? Or? Okay, engineered is already an anachronism. The word engineered suggests, you know, recombinant DNA technology. It's not engineered. What it was is a natural progression of new findings which suggested that there was a scientific base not only to the physical inheritance which anyone could see, you know, the black skin of the African, for example, but also in behavior. I think it was that transition from saying you can inherit height or strength or color of eyes or whatever other physical characteristic, the phenotype, so-called, or ancestors, but behavior is supposed to be part of nurture, part of what is taught, you know, by your teachers and by your parents and by your environment, that behavior is not an inherited characteristic. Well, we're still fighting about that. That's what the bell curve is trying to say, in fact, that behavior is a largely inherited characteristic. So when this transition was made, and to this day, you know, there are discussions about, for instance, violent behavior. There's an extra Y chromosome in some people that supposedly, and also this bipolar business, you know, the manic depressed behavior. You're depressed, you're behaving a certain. So there is a genetic basis. There's still an argument. But once this was brought forward as a real strong probability that behavior as well as physical characteristics are inherited, then, of course, if you want to do nation building, family building, whatever, you want to get the right engineered, if you will, eugenics into your society. That's, it sort of developed gradually. If you want one person, it's probably Alfred Plutz in Germany, who started a society for eugenics. And the one in the United States is Davenport, who was the most prominent, whose work I showed an example of, the most prominent eugenicist in the United States, Davenport.
Was Terman involved?
Who?
Terman, not the termite.
Yeah, he was, but only in, yeah.
Yeah.
get my notes and leave them, please.
The question was, what were the three conclusions that Dr. Benko came up with? And he is consulting his notes. Gene, if you can get it into 5 seconds.
A career opportunity. Some of you know I'm a veterinarian. The highest paid veterinarians in research are in the reproductive end, in the in vitro fertilization. And Dolly is going to send us out.
Way up. There's going to be an awful lot of pressure to do this cloning on all animals, including Homo sapiens. You can better believe it.
So if you're looking for a way to make easy money? I mean, this genetic engineering thing is an extremely problematic thing. You know, obviously, people are going to go into it because you can make money at it. And the ethical questions are endless. More questions? Oh, there was this question about the three conclusions.
I said that the three conclusions were my memory doesn't improve with age, even though I taught biology of aging. Maybe that's why. Human variability is greater within the group than between groups. The second one was descriptions of race are not reliable indicators of linkage of characteristics with respect to human potential. In other words, the fact that you name a race, you don't know the IQ. You don't know the height. You don't know the blood type. And the third one is that genetic configuration of all living things, including man, are not predetermined, and therefore determinism is not justifiable as social policy.
I imagine we can put that on the web page, too. Any more questions? Thank you very much for your rapt attention. We'll see you next week.